This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Good afternoon. The Waldridge Cap Center is pleased to host this special event, The Innovators, How a Group of Inventors, Hackers, Geniuses, and Geeks Created the Digital Revolution. That title's got to really work in a college audience. Innovators, Hackers, Geniuses, and Geeks. Following the lecture, Mr. Isaacson will take questions from the audience. Our speaker is known for his many biographies of innovative and creative people. Earlier, there was a well-received biography of Steve Jobs. And before that, there were books on Albert Einstein, Benjamin Franklin, and Henry Kissinger. Aside from his writings, he's had a remarkable career as a leader in journalism, news, and is already apparent in exploring innovative ideas. He joined Time magazine in 1978 and became the magazine's 14th editor in 1996. In 2001, he became chairman and CEO of CNN. And then in 2003, President and CEO of the Aspen Institute. It is my great pleasure to introduce to you Walter Isaacson.
All mine?
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you all very much. It's great to be back at UCSB, and especially to talk on a topic like this, because I'm not sure all of you all know it, but this is a very important place in the history of the digital revolution. UCSB was one of the four original nodes on the ARPANET, meaning the routers that were developed for the internet eventually. It starts off as the ARPANET, and it starts off here at SRI, UCLA, and Utah. And particularly important is what happened here was that the people who got these routers, such as UCSB, the research universities, they were told to come up with the protocols that would allow the routers to talk to the host computer, the routers to talk to each other. And being a research university like this, you know what the professors in charge did. They delegated that task to their graduate students. And so a bunch of graduate students, both from UCSB and UCLA, started writing what would be the protocols for the ARPANET and then the internet. And they kept waiting for people from back east, from the Pentagon, the bosses, to come descend on them and tell them how to do it and to dictate from on high how the internet would be built. But they started off with a party here at UCSB, the graduate students, Stephen Crocker, Vint Cerf, others who were involved. They decided to make this a fun process. And they also decided not to make it a top-down authoritarian process, but to make it collaborative, to share in the creation of what would become the internet. So Steve Crocker, who was here, he actually had a girlfriend. He was staying at his girlfriend's parents' house, and he got all nervous because he was in charge of writing down whatever they decided to do when they created the ARPANET. And he didn't want to be authoritarian about it. He had this deep belief that the internet was for all of us and it should be collaborative. And so he couldn't figure out what to call what they were writing. He didn't want to call it the regulations or the rules or the protocols, or even to call it proposals, because it would make it seem like somebody was trying to dictate how the internet would get built. And so he came up while standing in the shower very late at night, because it was the only place in the house he felt he could think. He came up with the notion of calling them requests for comment. Now, those of you who know the internet well know that the RFC process, the request for comment process, still exists. But number one was written by the graduate students here and at UCLA. And it started where they would just come up with ideas, and instead of imposing them, they would call it requests for comments. And eventually those became the rules of the road for the internet. I think that the fingerprints of that process, you can see it in how the internet evolved. It evolved as a packet switch network in which every single node has just as much power as any other. And there's peer-to-peer sharing. It was created by peer-to-peer sharing, and it facilitates peer-to-peer sharing. I remember thinking about that and writing about that when I was doing this book, The Innovators. And I thought, well, that's why they invented the internet. Why don't I try that? And I put up early drafts of my book on the internet. Now, we think of the internet now as the World Wide Web. I love the web. But it's not the internet, of course. It's just a set of protocols that rides on the internet. And it's not really my favorite way to use the internet, because it's sort of a publishing platform where people hand things down. So I went on some of the platforms that were like the old Usenet news groups and bulletin board systems. And those of you old enough like me to remember things like The Well and community bulletin boards. And I put up drafts of my book, and I said, request for comments. And all sorts of people started adding their stories into it. You know, when I was at Time Magazine and we wrote a story, we would send it around to the bureaus and say, comments and corrections, please, before we published it. And when I would write a book, I'd send it to 20 or 30 friends, say, hey, give me your comments. The first day I had this chapter about California and the birth of the internet up, I got 17,800 comments. Some by some of the great people who helped create the internet. Stuart Brand, who had written the Whole Earth Catalog, said, hey, you're not giving enough credit to the hippies. Liza Loop, who I'd never heard of, met her last night. She came to my talk in San Francisco. She was a community organizer, said we were using the internet to help organize and to take the power back from the corporations and the Pentagon. Then there were people like Steve Crocker, Bob Kahn, Vint Cerf. They all made their comments. And so that's what I want to talk about, and that's what this book is about how the digital revolution is a collaborative age. We know a lot about other revolutions. You know, we know about the American Revolution, and we know it was collaborative, that it wasn't just George Washington, you know, smiting his sword on the ground, and we have a revolution. But you have passionate people like John and Samuel Adams, and smart people like Jefferson and Madison, you know, people of great rectitude like Washington, and of course you have people who can hold them together, like Benjamin Franklin. And I found that was true of the digital revolution as well. But one of the things that was problematic about the revolution that we're all living, and I do want to make this a somewhat shorter speech than usual, because most people in this audience actually have grown up in the digital revolution, and I'd love to hear what I would call comments and corrections and questions, so I'll leave time for that. But as Wordsworth said of the French Revolution, bliss was it to be alive in that dawn. It was just wonderful for me growing up as an electronics geek, putting together circuit boards and Heathkits and ham radios, and then watching people like Steve Wozniak do it, and Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, and to watch how this revolution was born. But as I said, as a collaborative revolution, where creativity was a team effort, we don't actually know The names. These are unsung heroes. The people I've already mentioned, Steve Crocker, Vint Cerf, Bob Kahn. Bet you half of you in the audience, you know, didn't really know them, even though they're really cool people. And so that's what the point of this book is to resurrect the unsung heroes of the digital revolution who worked in teams. And unlike a Bill Gates or a Steve Jobs who became famous, they didn't become quite as famous, but they were really a creative force in this revolution. I start the book 100 years before the first computer, sort of a preface, and it's Ada Lovelace. Now, I told the story a little while ago. When my daughter, who's now 25, was applying to college, you know, she hadn't done that entrance essay you're supposed to do. And her mother was, shall I put it, quite anxious and eager and worried. And finally, Betsy came down and said, okay, I did the entrance essay, I sent it in. You know, we were parents, we thought we were supposed to help. Betsy didn't believe that. And I said, what did you do it on? And she said, Ada Lovelace. And I kind of vaguely knew the name, but I said, why Ada Lovelace? Who's Ada Lovelace? And she said, Dad, she was the first computer programmer and she invented the concept of the general purpose computer. She was Lord Byron's daughter. And Lady Byron, Lord Byron's wife, was not particularly fond of Lord Byron by the time Ada was growing up. If you're a student of poetry, you can probably understand why. Lord Byron was a bit of a, he didn't win Husband of the Year awards every year. And so she had Ada tutored mainly in mathematics. She thought maybe that would be an antidote to poetry if she studied math enough. Instead, Ada Lovelace became a good mathematician, but also a good poet, and she became a fan of what she called poetical science, the connection of the humanities to the sciences, the connection of the arts to our technology. That's what you do here. That's what places like liberal arts colleges with great research places do, is they make us connect the humanities to technology. When she was growing up, her mother took her to the Midlands of England in the 1820s and 1830s to see the mechanical looms that were using punch cards and engines to turn out tapestries. Her father, Lord Byron, was a Luddite, and I mean that literally. His only speech in the House of Lords was to support the followers of Ned Ludd, who were smashing the looms, thinking they would put people out of work. At the CAP Center here, you do a lot of studies of ethics and technology, ethics and science. Back then, they thought, gee, technology will put us out of work. We think that sometimes today. Back then, they were wrong. Today, they're wrong. Technology, when connected to our humanities, becomes an empowering force. And Ada, even if her father didn't understand it, understood that. She saw the punch cards that were being used to create the tapestries from the weaving machines and looms. And she thought about a calculating machine that her friend Charles Babbage was building called the analytical engine that used punch cards to do calculations. And what Ada comes up with is the concept that if you use punch cards like that, you can do more than just numbers. You can make the machine do anything that can be noted in symbols. Tapestries, patterns, art, words. She even said the machine will be able to make music, something that would have made her father flinch. Her father by that time had run away and was off with Mary Shelley. They wrote Frankenstein's Monster, one of the great memes that talks about what happens when our science and technology gets away from us. But Ada and Charles Babbage helped create this notion of the general purpose computer. So she's the first hero in my book, and I like to say she, because sometimes women get written out of the history of technology. It's astonishing and problematic to me that there are fewer women doing computer science now than there were 10, 15 years ago, that somehow they're not the role models. So it was good to sort of celebrate Ada Lovelace. You flash forward 100 years and you get to another character I find fascinating, Alan Turing. There's a movie coming out in about 3 weeks called The Imitation Game, and I hope you'll see it. It's about him helping build a computer to break the German wartime codes during World War II. But besides doing that, he's a fan and a student of Ada Lovelace. And he writes a paper about artificial intelligence. Because Ada Lovelace, besides saying a machine can do anything, put a caveat to it. Said machines will do anything, everything, except think. They won't be creative, they won't originate thoughts. So Alan Turing calls that Lady Lovelace's objection and writes a paper saying, how would we know that's true? He comes up with what we call the Turing test. It was an imitation game. You put a computer and a person in a separate room, you send in questions, and if you can't tell the difference between the answers the computer gives and the answer the human gives, then you have no empirical reason to say the machine's not thinking. Now, a lot of members of your philosophy department will say that's a stupid test. Probably is. But the interesting thing is, Turing said, and the machines will pass the test pretty soon. Believe it or not, artificial intelligence, despite all the people that will come to the stage and talk about the singularity and machine learning, somehow doesn't happen as fast as we thought. We still have machines that try to pass the Turing test and can only do so by doing conversational gimmicks and gambits. Nobody would confuse any of those machines for something that really could think. Instead, what we have is the theme that's launched by Ada Lovelace is that true creativity will come from combining human minds and machines, by making us more intimate with our technology, making our technology more personal, and having it connect with us. And throughout the history of the digital revolution, to me, that's the great theme, is connect the humanities to technology, connect humans to their machines. That's where you get what Doug Engelbart, one of the people in this book, calls augmented intelligence, amplifying what machines can do and amplifying what we can do. And that has become the more successful approach to the digital revolution. Alan Turing helped create a computer, the Colossus, using vacuum tubes. There's sometimes a debate about, well, who really created the first computer? And I take that on, and I love telling the tales of people because it gets me back to the collaboration theme that I find so important. In addition to the machine at Bletchley Park, which was done collaboratively by people like Tommy Flowers, who understood how to use vacuum tubes because he had worked at the British Phone Company, as well as people like Alan Turing, who understand philosophical logic and how to do it in a circuit, you have in the United States two contenders for who did the first electronic computer. And the computer at Bletchley Park was special purpose. It was just to break the German code. So to me, when I define computer, it has to be like Ada wanted, general purpose. It has to be able to be programmable so you can make it do all sorts of problems, not just break the German code. If you're a romantic historian, you may point to John Vincent Atanasoff, a guy at Iowa State University. I thought about him because I'm a biographer, and we biographers know, deep in our hearts, that we distort history a little bit. We distort history by finding one singular individual, like Einstein or a Franklin or a Jobs or Atanasoff, who in a garage or a garret has a light bulb moment and the rest of history changes because of that singular individual who innovated. As I said, in fact, like the internet, real innovation is a team sport, a collaborative sport. So Atanasoff, in his basement in Iowa State, creates a circuit board that works pretty well, can do logical processing. It's electronic. It uses vacuum tubes, most of it. But he's a loner. He doesn't really, you know, work with other people. He just got one graduate student working with him. And he could never quite get the thing built. He couldn't get it to be reprogrammed. He couldn't get the punch card burners to work. You know, he sort of had it a test, it kind of half worked, but he could never really get it working. Why? Because he did not have a team around him. And so when he goes off in the Navy in 1942 or 43, he leaves it in the Iowa State Physics Building basement, and somebody needs that room and dismantles it and throws it away. It would be lost to history except for one thing, a guy named John Mauchly. who is just the opposite of Anna Nassoff, a team builder, a Ben Franklin, somebody who loves bringing people together. I work at the Aspen Institute. We convene people. This is what Markley did. He grew up in Washington. His father was at the Carnegie Institute, a great scientific institute that brought people together, and at the Smithsonian. He was one of those people who loved to go to lectures, go to explorers clubs and sit in wood-paneled rooms and discuss different things with people, pick up ideas. So he decides he needs to help build a computer as the wartime is approaching. And so he starts traveling around like a bumblebee, picking up ideas and cross-pollinating them. He goes to starts at the 1939 World's Fair, goes up to Vassar, where they have vacuum tubes that are sort of working like a Geiger counter. He goes to Bell Labs. He goes all over the place, to Harvard, where the Mark I computer is being built by Howard Aiken and being programmed, as usual, by a woman, Lieutenant Grace Hopper. And then he's actually giving a talk somewhere, and Anna Nassoff appears. He was in the same building, and says, I'm building a computer myself in the basement of Iowa State. So John Markley gets in a car a month or so later and drives for 4 days from Washington to Iowa State to see what this guy is doing. He picks up some ideas there. And eventually he comes back to Penn, the University of Pennsylvania. And unlike Anna Nassoff, he creates a team. I think you're beginning to see the theme of this talk, which is creating a team is just as important as having the vision. Vision without execution is just hallucination. So, if you're going to execute, you need a team. He gets a great engineer named Presper Eckert. He finds mechanics who know how to make the card burners work. He finds all sorts of electrical engineers. And he even finds 6 women PhDs in math to do the programming of the machine, to know how to unplug the cables, replug the cables, set the switches to make the machine be able to do different problems. Back then, the boys with their toys thought the hardware was the most important thing, so they kind of thought programming it was women's work. Lo and behold, the programming of the machine became more important than the hardware. The hardware becomes interchangeable. But when they unveil the ENIAC, let me say, once again, the women are written out of the history. It's kept secret until 46 because the machine is doing ballistic missile for the wartime, and also John von Neumann is using it to do atomic bomb tests. These women, Frances Billis, Jean Jennings, are figuring out how to reprogram it so it can do the atom bomb test. Finally, in February of 1946, on Valentine's Day, they have a big unveiling, almost like a Steve Jobs product launch. Well, all the press is there, and they unveil ENIAC, the size of a room, flashing tubes, Gene Jennings and Francis Bullock and others doing the programming so it does different things. And they have a wonderful dinner that night, a black tie dinner, a candle lit, with all sorts of dignitaries and powerful people from Washington. And the women programmers were not invited. They took the bus back up the main line in Philadelphia on that cold February Valentine's night to their apartments. But that's once again why it was important to write this book. They're the unsung heroes. And unlike Anna Nassoff, he gets the machine working, Markley, Eckert, the women of ENIAC. And so to me, that's the first computer because it's done collaboratively as a team and it works. It becomes UNIVAC, it becomes with John von Neumann's stored program architecture, becomes really the basis for all big computers after that. It's an interesting tale because, you know, they then, even though they did it collaboratively, I hope there are no lawyers in this room, then it begins to become a bit of a legal issue because they want to take out patents on it. Penn doesn't want them to take patents. They quit Penn, start UNIVAC, take out the patents. Then they try to license the architecture of the computer around to other companies like Honeywell. Honeywell doesn't want to pay the licensing fees. And one of its lawyers dredges up John Vincent Anna Nassoff, who is by that point retired to the shore of Maryland. And as he's heard about Anna Nassoff, goes and visits him and said, yeah, Markley took some of my ideas. So for 15 years, there's an intellectual property patent war between Honeywell and Unisys over, and they invalidate the patents that Markley and Eckert had because the court says, well, they got the ideas from some of the ideas from Anna Nassoff. Whether or not that decision decision is correct or not. It does point out that in the end, you know, we shouldn't try to claim too much credit. We should be willing to share some of the credit, because that's what the most successful people of the digital age did. Once they invent that wonderful computer, you think the computer revolution has been launched. But no, I mean, these things are huge, hulking, mammoth things using, I think ENIAC had 17,800 vacuum tubes. So it took up a whole room, a whole lot of power. You had to be a major corporation or the Pentagon or the government or research university to even own one. What really starts a revolution is the microchip, the ability to etch on silicon or any semiconducting material. Somebody here we were talking about earlier with the chancellor just won the Nobel Prize for understanding how semiconductors can be other materials besides silicon. Is that the short form of how he wins the Nobel Prize? But at Bell Labs, they're doing that. They're creating the transistor. They're doing it with William Shockley, who is, back then, a brilliant physicist. He becomes a little paranoid later and then racist, but he works on a team with Bardeen and Bratton. And they understand the surface states of silicon. This is another reason I wrote the book. Because those of us who are not engineers, and maybe that doesn't include you, but it sort of includes me. My dad was an engineer. My uncles were engineers. I love soldering circuits and building Heath kits as a kid, but I never became a professional engineer. We sometimes get intimidated by, how does our technology work? Is it magic? Why is it when I type something on my phone, my daughter sees it across the country? How does that all work? And so I wanted to show how people understood the surface state of silicon, how that deals with quantum theory, but it's not all that difficult. It's not nearly as difficult as Lord Byron's poetry. I'm not quite sure what "she walks in beauty like the night" means, but I understand now how the electrons dance on the surface state of some silicon. And I think we should all try to do that. Those of us who love the arts and the humanities, who aren't engineers, should say, let me appreciate the coolness, not just of Lord Byron for writing that line, but the people at Bell Labs who made transistors. After they do so, the transistor is transformed by a wonderful team of people. Bill Shockley, the guy I said who was sort of a crazed, paranoid person who co-invents the transistor, starts, moves to California and starts actually the Westward Flow with some other people and starts Shockley Semiconductor in Silicon Valley. In fact, that's where Silicon Valley gets its name, is because those semiconductors taking sand and turning it into transistors. Shockley was not Ben Franklin. He was not good at collaborating, not good at making teams. There's a picture of him in my book in which he insisted, even though his name was not on the patent for the transistor, that the other people on the team, that his picture always be with them, that they never release a picture without him, because he was a leader of the group that oversaw that team. And just as they're taking the picture that ends up being the famous picture of them, he sits down at the microscope, even though it's not his, and grabs it so it pretends like he's the center of attention. So when he starts Shockley Semiconductor, he gets more and more paranoid, more and more racist, more and less willing to share credit. And he's got really brilliant people, these other unsung heroes of the digital revolution, working with him. People like Bob Noyce. Bob Noyce I love. Most of you have heard of him. He was one of the founders of Intel. But Bob Noyce is a quintessential person who can help make everybody around him smarter, help share credit. Grew up in Iowa. His father was a Congregationalist minister. Those of you who studied religion know that Congregationalists descended from the Puritans of New England. They don't even have lecterns or altars or anything else. It's just a congregation. Everybody is supposed to be somewhat equal in the congregation. You're supposed to all share and collaborate. He loved being a madrigal singing group, madrigal singing where there's no soloists. Everybody just has their part. Somewhat symbolic. We biographers always grab onto little threads like that, but that's the way he wanted to run the company. So he and Gordon Moore quit Shockley Semiconductor. They form Fairchild and then Intel. And they also create, besides the microchip, the culture of Silicon Valley, which is instead of having corner offices and walls and desks and hierarchies and organization charts, they just get one big old room. And Noyce sits there next to Gordon Moore. With battered desks in the middle of the room. Anybody wants to make a suggestion, they come up and talk to them. Now, that's not actually the most efficient way to get microchips out of the assembly line. So, like good team builders, they realize they're not good at saying no or being bossy in any way. So they hire Andy Grove as a third employee, and he gets things working. And that's another thing about teams. You always have to have the visionaries. You have to have the collaborators, but you also have to have the people who know how to execute, the people who know how to get things done. They invent the microchip, which is simply a way to etch many transistors on one piece of silicon instead of just one. And it becomes incredibly important because of the space program, because of government funding. And that's another thing that's really important, and UCSB is once again at the center of this, because when the ARPANET was started, it was a collaboration of private companies like BBN and Raytheon, the government, which was helping fund it, and researchers and graduate students at universities. Vannevar Bush, somebody everybody should read, once again, one of my unsung heroes, he helped put together many things. He built an electromechanical analog computer. He founded Raytheon. He did a lot of things, but the most important thing he did, I think, is come up with this notion of the three-way collaboration that was so important during the Eisenhower years, three-way collaboration between government, universities, and corporations. You get all sorts of institutes like RAND and SRI that are sort of halfway in between all these things. You get places like UCSB that on government contracts help build nodes for the internet, and so they have graduate students who get paid to research it, and it all works very well. Vannevar Bush called that the triangle. He wrote a wonderful paper, and Eisenhower implemented it, where the government funds basic research and doesn't do it in its own labs, but does it through universities, and then gives contracts to private corporations to turn the microchips into things you can put into the nose cone of rockets or whatever it may be. We are losing that now. For 50 years, as Vannevar Bush said, that created the seed corn, the basic fundamental research that becomes the laser, the transistor, the microchip, the internet, whatever you have it. Government funding, university research, corporate execution, that partnership really created the foundation upon which future inventions were done. And just in the past 5-10 years, we've started to decimate the research that the US government helps fund, basic research. In fact, I was up at Harvard about 4 years ago, 3 years ago, when the sequester came along, and I was talking to some of the graduate students who just got shut down, just really had to be let go, because the research that they were doing on viruses and the genetic engineering that could help change the way a virus spreads, the sequester had shut down the funding for that. It was going to be gone. And you think, okay, so what? Some researchers are out of work. Then Ebola comes along, and you say, hey, maybe we needed that basic research. And so you here at UCSB are in the forefront of this, but keep fighting for that notion that basic research is something to be valued. Anyway, they create the microchip, and that leads to another great leap. Because up until then, all this machinery was somewhat Orwellian. It was owned by, as I said, corporations and the government. It wasn't personal. But as Ada Lovelace taught us, the narrative of the digital age is not having machine learning and artificial intelligence. It's making our technology personal. So this Intel microchip comes along, and then a microprocessor. And some weird dude named Ed Roberts, who's a hobbyist, who loves making rocket ships in his backyard, lives in Albuquerque, goes bankrupt because he's making calculators, pocket calculators. And he's doing it because he's a hobbyist, and he has this hobby company, for geeks like me who like putting your own calculator together. You'd buy a kit, and you got to assemble it. The problem he began to face was that the kits he was sending out that people had to assemble cost more than a calculator you could buy from Japan already made. So he was going out of business, and like a good entrepreneur, as he goes bankrupt, he decides to double down. He takes out another loan, takes all of his money, and says, I'm going to use this microprocessor and make a kit that's a computer, a personal computer. So he makes the Altair. Now, the Altair doesn't do much of anything. I was up at the Computer History Museum last night. It has a lot of lights on the front and a few switches, and you can try to make it do a few things. But boy, the minute it gets released, it gets on the cover of Popular Electronics, and geeks and nerds and hackers and pinheads and phone freakers around the country go totally nuts, and they want the Altair. They drive to Albuquerque to try to get it. When it appears on the newsstand in Popular Electronics, it's in the Harvard Square newsstand, and a guy named Paul Allen, who had dropped out of college because his friend Bill Gates had gone to Cambridge and convinced Paul Allen just to come hang out there, sees it on the newsstand and says, oh my God, this is happening without us. And he buys a copy and he runs through the sludgy snow that December to Courier House, the dorm of his friend Bill Gates, and says, we got to get on this thing. And so Gates blows off totally exam period. He ends up having to leave Harvard, but he doesn't care because they sit there using a Defense Department funded machine in the Harvard Science Center next to the one that Howard Aiken and Grace Hopper had programmed to write BASIC for the Altair so that geeks and hobbyists and hackers like him and his friends could actually use this machine to actually do something. They call up Ed Roberts in Albuquerque to say, okay, we're going to write this BASIC and we wanted you to pay for it and have it included with the Altair. Bill Gates couldn't even shave back then. He had a high, squeaky voice, but he's the one who knew how to do the programming. But they knew that Paul was going to be, because he could actually grow sideburns and look like a grown-up and had a suit, he was going to be the one to go to Albuquerque. And they finally figured out that Bill Gates would call Ed Roberts, the guy who owned this little hobbyist shop in Albuquerque, and pretend to be Paul Allen and say, I'm Paul Allen and we've got this thing. And when Ed Roberts said, sure, come and show it to me, Paul Allen goes, and BASIC, they do something brilliant, Bill Gates does, proving that business is part of innovation as well, which is instead of selling it to the Altair, they license it. So it becomes a standard, and they still have the rights to the BASIC. They pull that trick with IBM a few years later, too, when they write the disk operating system, license it to IBM, but it becomes Microsoft DOS and then Microsoft Windows. Another person who saw this Altair was at the Homebrew Computer Club. Homebrew Computer Club was near Palo Alto, and it was that collection that makes California such a hotbed of innovation. It had, you know, all sorts of electronics people who had worked in Hewlett-Packard, but also people like Liza Loop, who were community organizers, people who were part of the anti-war movement and were quite rebellious and wanted to take power back from the Pentagon, and hippies and people who were part of the electric Kool-Aid acid tests and were dropping acid and were also rebellious and anti-authoritarian. So at the Homebrew Computer Club, the Altair arrives. They basically steal the paper tape, which has Bill Gates or Microsoft BASIC on it, and make copies. Bill Gates writes an enraged letter. But that's the beginning of the struggle between open source software and proprietary software. But something else happens that day when the Altair is first shown off. A chubby, real shy kid named Steve Wozniak looks at the Altair and looks at the specs for the Intel 8088 microprocessor. Says, I can do better than that. I can make a circuit board that's even cooler. I can connect it to a keyboard and a monitor. So he writes out the specs, and the next Homebrew Computer Club meeting, he makes copies of them. And he gives them away for free to everybody in the Homebrew Computer Club. And with him is a friend from down the street, Steve Jobs, still in high school. And Jobs says, wait a minute, why are you giving that away? We can go to my parents' garage and we can make these circuit boards. And thus, Apple is born. So out of that one little innovation, you see Microsoft and Apple being born. and a certain rebelliousness too. People like Woz, who are in favor of sharing and open source, people like Steve Jobs, who want a proprietary system. And I thought, people ask, you know, what's the better way? What's, you know, isn't it much better to have open source like GNU Linux and, you know, Wikipedias and, you know, Android, whatever, maybe more open source? Or is it better to be in a Steve Jobs walled garden where the hardware, the software, content are all connected tightly, integrated, and very proprietary? You can't even open the back of your devices. And I say, you know, it's a great thing about the digital age is it's the tension, it's the dynamic between the two, the sort of dialectic that really spurs along innovation. So these are the type of lessons that I tried to bring to the fore. And I want to end, so we do have time for questions like I promised, by going back to Ada Lovelace, because my book ends as it begins. It ends with Ada Lovelace in a chapter called Ada Forever. Because when I looked at the subsequent innovations in the book, even Google, blogs, you name it, the World Wide Web, it wasn't about creating machines that operated without us. It wasn't about creating artificial intelligence. It wasn't pursuing the vision of Alan Turing. Even Google, which we think is magic, is simply two graduate students who did an algorithm not to search the web and figure out what pages ranked best, but to search the web and to figure out what human beings thought pages ranked best. All the Google web crawler does, all the algorithm does, is gathers millions, billions of links that real humans have put on their web pages and figures out how to bring that together. So the combination of human imagination and technology creates a search engine. When you look at Watson, the machine that wins at Jeopardy, what is IBM doing with it now? It's doing it in collaboration with doctors to do cancer diagnosis, because the machine can't do it on its own, but the doctors can't, but together they do it better. Same with Deep Blue, the machine that beat Kasparov in chess. Kasparov now has a contest in which a machine and human play as a team against anybody, the best machine, the best grandmaster. And even people who are not masters at chess, combined with pure laptop computers, can always beat the best computer or the best human. That combination of the humanities and technology has been the story of the digital age. So that's why it's important, I think, as Ada Lovelace did, to stand at that intersection. Whenever Steve Jobs ended one of his product launches, there was always a slide on the screen, and it was a street signs showing the intersection of the liberal arts and the sciences. And he said, those who stand in that intersection will be the ones who will create the value. And it's even more true now. It's not just about engineering. It's about connecting creativity, the creative industries, journalism, arts, fashion, interactive role-playing games, collaborative books, whatever you want, finding new mediums that are a connection of creative industries with the technology industries. So that's why I think it's very important for people who are in the creative industries to have a real feel for technology, to understand what an on-off switch is, how it works in a semiconductor, how real people, people you may never have heard of, invented really cool things. People who are in the humanities, they sometimes brag and they say, okay, you know, we need more arts, not just STEM education. That's true. They would be appalled, though, if somebody didn't know the difference between Hamlet and Macbeth, for example. But then I say to them, do you know the difference between a capacitor and a transistor, or between a gene and a chromosome, or between an integral or a differential equation? And they act proud that they don't know that. No, all of us in the arts and the humanities should really endeavor to learn the beauty of science, to figure out how Einstein made the creative leap, that time is relative, to figure out how Bob Noyce made the leap of how you etch a transistor onto a piece of silicone. But also it's true, and this is the converse, and this is the Ada Lovelace tale, is that in the end, too, we must nurture the humanities. and the arts, because it's those who understand not just the engineering, but how to make it personal, how to connect the humanities to it, and even more important, as you do here at UCSB, to understand the human ethics, the social ethics, the social networking ethics of what we're supposed to do with our technology. As I said at the beginning, we've always been good at keeping up with our technology. Our humanities have always been good. Our ability to think ethically, morally about our technology has pretty much kept up. Few mistakes, some really big mistakes, but in general, we've been good as a human species. Even now, as the NSA is eavesdropping, but James Risen of the New York Times is exposing it and arresting him, you can talk and you can see how we're wrestling with it and how we're doing it publicly and how we're doing it in an ethical way. And I suspect eventually we'll get the balance right. And if we do, it will be because of people like yourselves who stood at the intersection of the humanities and the science and were awed by the imagination and the beauty of both. Thank you all very much. Let's do some questions. I spoke fast so that we'll have a lot of time. And especially some of those of you, I can't see too well. Are the microphones in the back, too, or?
No, just these two.
Just these two. Okay, go ahead, sir.
Yes, the Homo sapiens seems unable to stop technology and the change. What are the unintended consequences of just keep going with this?
I think it's important, as I said, for us to keep up morally with our technology. We have been a species, as Aristotle says, we're a social animal. We know how to use our technology to connect us and to bind us. And the consequences of us either being alienated from our technology because we don't think we have to understand it, or letting the engineers run everything, bad consequences. But as I said, I'm an optimist. America, its democracy, its open and free way of being comfortable with the free flow of ideas gets a lot of things wrong, but eventually, it argues it through and gets it right. Yes, sir.
Thanks for being back in Santa Barbara. I know you've been researching this for several years, so what's your thoughts on the net neutrality issue that Washington's wrestling with right now?
Well, I'm definitely, desperately, fervently in favor of net neutrality. And you should fight for it. And to be a little bit more controversial, you should fight against corporations that might control your broadband access. I used to work for Time Warner. There is no reason why Time Warner and Comcast should have a dominance of broadband access into the home. There are really good things happening. Francis Hoffman and I were just talking about Reed Hastings and Netflix. They're breaking the back of the monopolies of the cable companies that get to bundle and tell you what to go into your home. CBS is now doing it. HBO is now doing it. This disruption because of the technology will be really good, but it will only be good if we don't have a stranglehold where a few groups, say corporations, whatever they may be, control the distribution pipe. You don't want anybody to have over control of that pipe. So net neutrality is something I'm in favor of, but that's only half the game. You know, because you could tell Comcast, Time Warner, you have to be net neutral, you gotta make sure all the bits are somewhat equal, but they're still going to bundle services, and who knows what's gonna happen next? Who knows what Twitter or SMS messaging or, you know, new technology will come along that the regulators will never keep up with. So always fight for ways of competition that whether, and I mean, I love all of these companies, but whether it's an Amazon or a Time Warner, Comcast or whatever, no one entity should have too much control over the distribution system because that strangles the free flow of ideas. Yes, sir. I need some more questions. Keep thinking of them. Come on down. Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could comment on the role of software patents. On one hand, your talk focused on the value of collaboration and good teams, but on the other hand, people are often motivated by wanting to profit from their efforts.
Right. You know, being at the Aspen Institute, I always think it's a balance. I mean, I don't think, you know, that software patents are evil. And I also don't think that people should be able to invent one click and patent it, if you know what I mean. That processes shouldn't be patented. We actually see the pendulum swinging back in the past year or so, away from intellectual property rights and software patents being given willy-nilly, and the courts have reined that in quite a bit, especially with the advent of what are sometimes called patent trolls, and you're just buying these things up. I'll go back to my daughter. My daughter, in the wisdom of youth, used to be totally against any form of copyright or patents of intellectual property. And I'd say to her, you know, I've written this book, Steve Jobs, whatever it may be. And ever since the Statute of Anne was created 450 years ago in England, that it says when somebody creates something intellectual and it is copied, they have a copyright to get a royalty from that. This is something that created 450 years ago, an explosion of a great economy of people creating intellectual property. So we like that. We want that to occur. And we want Bob Noyce and Gordon Moore, when they have to get venture capital from Arthur Rock, who's inventing venture capital, and they finally create Intel, and they make a microchip, you want them to say, okay, we can now charge for it, make a profit. And so I'm in favor of protecting, that's not software, but it's close to software, I mean, in some ways. I do also, I mean, I've been lectured to enough and have as one of my heroes in the book, Richard Stallman, who is furious that Bell and everybody else is patenting and copywriting Unix, and they have intellectual property rights. So he creates Linux and GNU Linux and everything else. So it's open source and free. And that's cool as well. And that ability to have the tension between the two. And for us, I mean, it's once again, why you got to study what you're studying here, is that only people who really get us, who know software, who understand a little bit about coding, and everybody should, just like you should know a little bit of French and maybe even Latin, you should know a little bit of C++ or Java at least, so that you understand how creative a piece of software can be, what in it probably deserves to be patented or protected, and what should be open and free. It's kind of wonderful to me, looking at the free and open software movements, that people like doing that, that they edit Wikipedia, that they contribute to Linux coding. And that shows that we're not all just mercenary, that we like being part of the revolution. So you want to make sure you nurture that, where you still allow, you know, the people who create an app, you know, for the phone. And, you know, like a lot of my daughter's friends, they're sitting home creating apps. You know, you don't want people to then just copy it. And I read Bill Gates's letter to the hobbyists where they copied his Microsoft BASIC. And I think, gee, what a jerk. And gee, he was right. And so we have to be able to keep that balance in our heads.
Okay, the question I have is that, and it has to do with investment in infrastructure and actually delivering these services. Well, we invent the technology, we invented it, and we have all these wonderful devices, but if you look at the actual delivery of the services, we've slipped a long ways down the ladder compared to other countries.
Oh, what are you talking about, broadband?
Yeah,
or?
I'm talking about broadband in Santa Barbara here. We just have Cox Cable. I can't comment publicly on how terrible they are, but I mean, we're at a stranglehold
here. You just did, but okay.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Thank you. I think a lot of people agree with me. And what I don't see is the commitment to infrastructure. It's like we don't take care of our water systems and our plumbing pipes in the cities, and we don't reinvest in the delivery mechanism.
Absolutely.
And rural areas particularly suffer.
Absolutely. It's a bad problem. It comes partly down to where I now live, which is Washington, D.C., which there used to be a general consensus. Eisenhower had his scientists, you know, Lyndon Johnson is there as majority leader of the Senate. Al Gore Sr., not Jr., is saying, okay, we need an interstate highway system. Al Gore Jr., who gets punchline of jokes, but he actually did help fund the ARPANET and then open the ARPANET and the internet so that the public could use it and not just researchers. And there was a lot of government funding for it, and it was a national consensus. I don't know what happened to that national consensus. It became a liberal conservative issue, which it probably shouldn't have been. I don't think Eisenhower was the most liberal of our presidents, but you know, he understood the need for infrastructure. And to me, it's very similar to the basic research question. If we're going to give up on basic research and we're going to allow monopolies to have the cable companies that do broadband and then not have competition so that there's no infrastructure improvements, and we also have, to make myself sound not a liberal now, but a conservative, a regulatory and not in my backyard, and you can more easily stop like Google Fiber if it wants to come compete with Comcast, y'all are in favor of that. You would cheer. And then they would start digging up a road or digging up a backyard or putting it over a school, and somehow the city council would spend the next, you know, 8 months debating it, and it would never get done. So Steve Jobs used to complain about that. It's just hard to get things done in this country now. And I think we need to rededicate ourselves to that spirit of enterprise, that spirit of revolution, that spirit of collaboration between government, universities, private industries, in which we said we can build it. And I really don't know what to do, but I actually think it's more of a political problem, not a technological one. Yes, sir.
You mentioned the crossroads of humans and machines and how humans have built the machines. What does the future look like? I mean, to some extent, now we have reached the point where humans and machines are evolving together. There is feedback from mm-hmm. the machines to how humans will evolve. And mm-hmm. what does the future hold in how will they co-evolve in the future?
Co-evolution is a concept that Douglas Engelbart, who invented the mouse and was a Californian visionary who's another of those cool unsung heroes of my book, talked about just what you did, which is that instead of machines running off without us or us not understanding machines, we become more closely connected and we co-evolve in a way. I think you're seeing that happen even with Apple Watch or whatever it is. These devices that connect to us much more intimately. And I think that evolution requires us remaining in control in a way, not sort of being intimidated or alienated from our machines, but realizing that they're going to help us think. People worry about, okay, you know, kids on video games or, you know, maybe texting and tweeting, and that Wikipedia makes it feel like you don't have to learn anything anymore because you can just Google it and find it on the internet or look it up on Wikipedia. And it reminds me a little bit, not that I'm old enough to remember, of Plato and Aristotle debating whether or not writing, the fact that they've invented writing and they have papyrus and stuff, they said, well, that will destroy rhetoric. Our minds won't evolve the way they should because we'll write things down and we won't have to memorize plays and things. Well, we kind of survived the advent of writing. And I think we'll have survived the advent of Google and Wikipedia. But it's one of those things that once again gets me back to why people who love the humanities and the social sciences and history should also love technology. Because you got to think about it together. Thank you all very disappear. Thank you all very much. I'll sign books, and it's Book Den, right? One of your wonderful local booksellers, an independent Book Den. I'll come sign books for you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great.
Bye.